one of the things that I believe that God is speaking for us in this year, in 2017, is for us to understand where he's taking the church and what the church is looking at and looking forward to, what's coming in human history, and where the church is going. Now, I'm not saying this is all going to transpire this year. I don't expect Jesus to return in 2017. Okay? I'll give you that clue. But I do think he's coming. And I do think that the end of the age is approaching. And as that occurs, as that happens, we're going to see things coming into the earth more and more and more, change in the earth, preparing for that to transpire. Now, just by way of review a tiny bit here, God fought the First World War, not in the natural, but God's first World War or First Reformation took place when Jesus came to earth, right? You know that. We've talked about this before a little bit. Jesus, in John 17:4, Jesus is praying prophetically, and, you know, he states, "I have finished the work that you've given me to do." That's what Jesus said to God, right? That's what Jesus said to the Father. Praying prophetically here in the earth, Jesus said, "I've finished the work that you've given me to do." This was in the first Reformation, when Jesus came to earth and established a new covenant, a better covenant for you and I, a different way for humanity, right? And John 17:14, again, Jesus praying prophetically says, "I have finished my work." And what work was he talking about? What work was Jesus talking about when he says, "I've finished my work"? He's talking about his 3 years of ministry on the earth. He's finished all that God gave him to do in that time frame, all that he knew was his mission in the earth, in his natural physical body. It's like this, you know, hands and feet and hair and everything else, you know, in his natural physical body, his human body form, he had finished all the work that God gave him to do. On the cross, he cried out, "It is finished." You know, redemption was bought then and there. It was paid for. It was done. The things that had been lost by the fall of man have been restored to man rightfully, given back to us, restored to us, or at least the opportunity to have these things was there for us now. And again, because of the work that Jesus did, and he cried that out on the cross, "It is finished." God fulfilled many of his purposes for creating mankind. God fulfilled them during the life of Christ. Many of God's original purposes for the creation of man were restored in the life of Christ, in his natural human life. If you've never read Bishop Hammond's book, "Who Am I and Why Am I Here?" you ought to get a copy of it and read it. "Who Am I and Why Am I Here?" talks about what were God's purposes in creating man. What were his purposes? Again, that's Bishop Hammond, one of his books, "Who Am I and Why Am I Here?" And it talks about God's purposes. Many times if you ask people, you know, what are God's, you know, why did God create mankind? Well, you know, they would tell you, you know, to so that we can fellowship with him, right? And that's true. That's one reason. And they would tell you, you know, so that we can worship him. That's true. It's another reason. But there are, those are the ones that come to mind quickly, right? Those are the most common answers that people would give. But there are many other reasons why God created humanity. Why God created mankind. There are other reasons. And again, in Bishop's book, Who Am I and Why Am I Here? You can, you know, he breaks that down very well and gives a real theological explanation of it, etc., but in a readable and understandable way. But God fulfilled many of those purposes in the physical body of Jesus Christ, in Christ's life in the earth. Now, look at one of the other, I want you to look at back to scripture, 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. A reason and why Jesus came to the earth. You know this scripture. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That he might destroy the works of the devil. Now, what did the devil bring into the earth? He brought sin. He brought disease and sickness and corruption and all manner of evil, right, into the earth. These are the things that Satan was responsible for in the earth. And Jesus came to destroy those works, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him. In other words, when you're born again, you're going to have a strong desire not to sin. Doesn't mean that you'll never, ever sin if you're born again. If that's the case, then we all might as well, you know, pack it in. We're all going to hell, right? I mean, that's how it would be, period. Because there is none of us who can say we are without sin, right? So whoever has been born of God does not sin. In other words, does not remain in sin, does not have strong desire to sin, does not let the desire to sin or the natural human tendency to sin, does not allow that to override his desire for God. I think Nicole mentioned that, you know, about our thought lives and our desire for God, causing that to rise up and focusing on that and allowing that to override our natural human desires for sin and other ungodly pursuits. And sometimes, you know, it's not just an ungodly pursuit. Sometimes it might be something that's not in and of itself wrong, and yet it in and of itself drags us away from our pursuit of God. Right? I mean, I've often said, you know, I would never tell a Christian, you know, if you have an opportunity to work on a Sunday morning, not to take it. There are times in my life when I've had to work on a Sunday morning. But I would never take a job that I had to work all the time on Sunday mornings. I wouldn't do that. I don't think a Christian should do that. Now, not that you can't meet with God at another time, in another place, and all of that. You can. But if you, chances are pretty good that if your main contact with church is on a Sunday morning, and if you have to work every Sunday morning, what's going to happen? You're going to lose that contact. And church is not, should never be your only contact with God. If it is, you're going to be a pretty weak believer. If when I say church, I mean church on a Sunday morning, right? You understand what I mean? But if that's your only contact with God, if that's the only time that you delve into His Word, if it's the only time that you pray, if it's the only time that you worship, you're going to be a pretty weak believer. I hadn't been to the gym for a long, too much, you know, and I went to the gym the other day, and man, was I sore when I was done. A pretty weak believer, a pretty weak gym member. You know what I mean? So, and it's the same thing. Faith is like a muscle, in a sense. Faith is like a muscle. You need to exercise it. You need to exercise it. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him. What's he talking about? God's seed, it is his word. It's his life. Remains in him, in the believer. His seed remains in us. If we're born again, God's seed remains in us. And he being God cannot sin, and he being the believer cannot sin, or cannot remain in sin and stay in sin and pursue sin. Why? Why? Because we're born of God. Because we're born of God. Jesus came to destroy those works of the devil. So after Jesus, God's, you know, World War I, let's say, Jesus coming to earth, establishing a new covenant, a better way, a new only way, let's say, to God. After that, what happened? Jesus tells us what's going to happen. He gave his ministry to the church. He gave his authority and his power, etc., to the church. Right? Now, that's not the church ecclesiastical, so to speak, the organization of the church, but that's you and I. That's humanity in the church. It's his called ones, his called out ones, his you know, we get the word ecclesiastic from the word in the Greek ekklesia, right? For the word for church. Well, do you know that that word literally means a body of that's brought together to rule. It's like a parliament or a type of thing. It's brought together to rule. That's what that one meaning or what that word literally means, and that is what Jesus did in giving his ministry to the church. He took his ministry and broke it into five parts, if you will, apostle and prophet and pastor and evangelist and teacher, and he gave that to the church. He says, I will build my church. The fivefold ministers are to be builders of the church. Now, that doesn't mean builders of buildings. It means builders of people. It means builders of people, bringing people to maturity in the body of Christ, that they can stand and fight the enemy and be part of God's end-time army of the Lord, if you will. He also gave the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Who did he give them to? All of us. Yeah. He gave them to the saints. He gave them to the church in order to, for what purpose? To continue the work that he did when he was here in his physical body. The church is to continue that work that he did, to continue it, right? And he says, Jesus says in, where's it at? It's in John I think I wrote it down. I think it's John 17. Look at John 17. Flip back there once. I don't think I did write it down. I don't see it in my notes anywhere. In Jesus' prophetic prayers here, I did mention this earlier. In John 17:4, Jesus praying prophetically, he says, "I have glorified you on the earth. I've finished the work which you have given me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was." And then he goes on and he prays for all believers. For all believers. He prays for the apostles which were given to him. And then he prays for all the believers. I did not write that scripture down. I'm sorry, I don't remember. The scripture where Jesus says that... that those who believe in his name will do greater works than he. John 14:12. Thank you. I knew it was John. I just couldn't remember where. See, Brian's got that business right up there in his head, man. John 14:12. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do. Why? Because I go to be with my Father. Because I go to be with my Father, you'll do greater works than Jesus. Now, you know, we can come about that a lot of ways. But literally it says greater works than Jesus has done. If we believe in him, we at least have that capability and that possibility. And the church surely has that capability to reach into the entire earth. Jesus couldn't reach the entire earth. You know, in Jesus Christ Superstar, there's a song or a line says, you know, what it says, singing about Jesus. I think it's Judas singing about Jesus, says, "Why did you come now? 2,000 years ago. Why did you come now? There's no mass communication. There's no, you know, all of this." Right? I forget the name of the song in Jesus Christ Superstar. Maybe you've never heard it. Maybe you have. I don't know. But Judas has a line, you know, if you'd have come today, you would have reached a whole nation. Israel in 4 BC had no mass communication. That's the line. I knew I'd remember it if I thought about it a moment. And it's true, Jesus couldn't even reach all of Israel. He certainly couldn't reach all of the Mediterranean, let alone the whole earth. But today there are believers in every continent, in probably just about every nation on earth, if not all. And that time is coming when the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our God and of his Christ, when there will be believers in every nation on earth. That time is coming. And this is the work of the church, to spread the gospel throughout the earth, that the glory of the Lord may fill the earth. That it may fill the earth. Right? That's our part. Whose part is that? It's not Jesus' part. It's our part. That's us. That's for the church to do. Right? Listen. This was, God's first world war. His second world war was the Reformation with Martin Luther, and now we're coming to God's Third World War. And this is that time when Jesus has given his gifts to the church, and there's fresh outpouring, fresh fire, fresh zeal, fresh manifestation. Look at Acts chapter 3. Actually, I want you to look at, yeah, let's look at Acts 3. Go ahead and turn that quote. Acts chapter 3, verse 21. You know this scripture probably, because I know I've preached it a lot here and there over the last few years. This is coming. This is what's coming to the church. Last week, Pastor Angie played a prophetic message from Kim Clement, right? And that prophetic message, I'm not sure what year it was from, maybe 2008 or 7 or something like that. It was a ways back, I think, 2007. And in that prophetic message, he prophesied that the next president, which is now, that in the middle of his term, a woman would rise up. That's you and I. That's the church arising. That's the church arising. Concerning Christ himself, Peter was preaching, and he says, "Repent therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, that he may send Jesus Christ." That he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, excuse me, whom heaven must receive until the times of restoration of all things. Which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. That he may send, who's the he in that sentence? God the Father, that he may send Jesus. Where's Jesus now? Seated at the right hand of God the Father, where he ever lives to make intercession for the saints, by the way, that's you and I. Jesus is seated at the right hand of God the Father in his glorified human body, not as a spirit, so to speak, but in his glorified human body, he is seated at the right hand of God the Father, where he ever lives to intercede for you and I. His power is available to us. His grace is available to us. He's praying for us. Thank you. His power and his grace is available to us. It got away. Thank you. The floor is clean. We have that, 15-second rule or something? However long this stuff is on the floor, my rule goes longer. It depends, you know. Now, you in the front row there, You be prepared so I don't blow this out at you. All right? His grace and his power, it is available to us, but not to heap on ourselves, but not so we can feel good, so that we can demonstrate his glory and spread it across the earth. That might be to your next door neighbor. Like Carolyn providing an act of kindness for a woman that she doesn't know. It might be you speaking to your neighbor and sharing the love of Jesus Christ with her or him. It might be you praying for the sick praying for the lost. Nicole was talking about her prayer being violent. And maybe you in your prayer closet praying violently for the lost, or praying violently for your own loved ones. But Jesus gave his ministry to the church. Look at Hebrews 1:13. Heaven, and I'm still in Acts 3. Heaven must receive Jesus until the time of restorations, until the Father decides it's time to send him back, until all things that have to be fulfilled are fulfilled and he can return. So there are prophetic, listen, here's, I'm just pumping all bishops' books today. This is a commercial for bishops' books. Prophetic scriptures yet to be fulfilled. Bishop wrote a book, excellent book. Prophetic scriptures, you read that? Prophetic scriptures yet to be fulfilled. We often hear preachers say, oh, Jesus could come any day. That's hogwash. Not true. He can't return until all things which have been spoken by the prophets have been fulfilled. It hasn't happened yet. Therefore, Jesus can't return yet. He's waiting on a few things yet that have to be tied up. A few loose ends that God has to wrap up before Jesus can return. You ought to read that book. I think it's 17. Is it 17? 17? No. I can't. Maybe he doesn't give a number. I'm not sure. But he says prophetic script. The title is Prophetic Scriptures Yet to be Fulfilled. Something like that. You can't miss it if you look for something close to that title under Bishop Hammond's name. Christ can't return until everything spoken by the mouth of all his prophets since the world began is yet fulfilled. But when that time comes, there'll be a shout and the sky is going to open up. We're going to see him returning. Jump over to Hebrews chapter 1. Here's one of the things. Listen to Hebrews chapter 1, verse 13. But to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool? Jesus has to sit at God's right hand until his enemies are made his footstool. Would you agree in the earth that the enemies of the Lord are not yet made his footstool? Now, we know that, you know, God reigns and rules the heavens and the earth. And in that sense, you could say, in a spiritual sense, some ethereal float in the sky thing, you could say God's enemies are made his footstool. That Jesus' enemies have been made his footstool. But it surely isn't so in the earth today. In this natural physical world, it isn't so. Look at Hebrews chapter 10. Just to reiterate that same thing. And every priest stands ministering in verse 11, Hebrews 10, 11. And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But this man being Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. From that time waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. So Jesus is sitting at the right hand of God the Father waiting until his enemies are made his footstool. And at that time, Jesus will return. At that time, Jesus will return. The next, and you can see, you can read about that in 1 Thessalonians. Look at what comes there. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and these are the days and the hours that are approaching at some point. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, but I do not want you to be ignorant, in verse 13, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, those who have passed away in Christ, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Christ. For this way we say to you, for this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. So the dead in Christ will rise as the Lord returns. The dead in Christ will rise and will meet him. And then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the air, in the clouds, and we will meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. So this in 1 Thessalonians, describing what everybody calls the rapture, so to speak, and that day and that time is coming. Many people say that Bishop Hammond doesn't believe in the rapture. Well, he does believe in the rapture. He doesn't believe that the rapture is going to come to get us out of trouble. God hasn't ever taken his people and just taken them out of trouble, so to speak, and pulled them out, let's say. He's never done that. But what God has always done with his people, and, you know, what Bishop believes is that exactly what the word says here is going to happen. The Lord's going to return with a shout. The dead in Christ are going to rise, and us who are alive, you know, if we're alive at that time, we're going to be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, as the Bible says, from our earthly body into a heavenly body, whatever that is. I don't know exactly what that is. Evidently, when I'm in my heavenly body, I'll be able to pass through walls, and yet I'll still be able to eat fish. I hope I can still eat steak, too, you know. But fish, I'll take fish. I like fish. Right? Steak's pretty good stuff. Right? So I know a little bit about my heavenly body. It's going to be just like Jesus' heavenly body. Right? So Bishop believes that will happen. There will be a rapture, but probably not in quite the same sense that some people picture the rapture. The thing that we don't know and don't always understand or comprehend is exactly the timing of these things. How much of what God has, of the work that has to be completed before the final end game comes, how much of that work will the church complete in our earthly bodies, and how much of it will we complete in our heavenly bodies? That's what Bishop says. God hasn't told him. He doesn't know. We don't know. We really don't know. We know that it is that Jesus came and completed his work and commissioned the church, and the church is to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to every corner of the earth. and that God is in the process of making sheep and goat nations in the earth. We know that Jesus will return and judge those sheep and goat nations. And after he does so, we know that the church will reign and rule with him. That's you. That's you, baby. We know that the church will reign and rule with Jesus Christ for 1,000 years. Right? We know that. The church will be part of that great army that God described in Joel chapter 2, and that is the army of the Lord. That is the church that will sweep throughout the earth. More souls are going to come into the kingdom in this time period than ever before. It's going to be the greatest revival ever seen. And we know that the church going to be that army of the Lord that's going to declare and decree according to Psalm 149, that's going to declare the written judgments. That's the church. That's us. We're going to declare the written judgments. We know according to the book of Jeremiah that God says we're a battle axe in his hands. Guys, don't tell your wife she's a battle axe. Don't do that. But she is a battle axe in the hands of the Lord. That's his church. That's us. We don't know all the details, but we know that when we do everything we can do, God will do the rest. Remember Jonathan, don't you? You remember how Jonathan and his servant? Jonathan had a sword, not quite a battle axe, but a sword. His servant had a war club, and that thing didn't look like our war sticks back there. That was a club. That baby had an end on it. You had to be strong to swing it. Jonathan and his servant climbed up a mountain, and Jonathan said to his servant, you know, they climbed up a mountain, and on the top of the mountain was a garrison of the Philistines, about 500 men, right? So there's Jonathan and his servant, his armor bearer, and they climbed up the mountain, and there's the garrison, and Jonathan says, hey, you know, to his servant, you know, his servant's going, hey, what are we doing? You're trying to get us killed. Jonathan says, hey, you know, we get up here. If they invite us inside, then we'll take that as a sign from the Lord that we're to attack. Sounds like a plan, right? His servant's thinking, this guy's an idiot. God, get me out of here. Jonathan and his servant climb up that mountain, and the Philistines, hey, come on in. And they open the gate and let them in. And so they go in. Now there's Jonathan and his armor bearer in the city with 500 Philistines. So Jonathan attacks. Pulls his sword and attacks 500 of them. And one by one, he fights with them. And every time he knocks them down with his sword, slices a leg or something, and they fall to the ground. His servant takes that war club, wham! And about 20 of them die that way. Takes about an hour. And the Lord says, I better intervene. He can't do this all day. I better intervene. Takes out 500 of them. You know what he did? You know what the Lord literally did? He sent Michael and his army of angels into that city and a spirit of confusion. And those Philistines went crazy and just started swinging their swords at anything that moved. And they killed each other. You heard of a man named Gideon. What chance did he have against those Philistines? God pared his army down. Gideon raised an army, and God said, no, no, no. You're not going to get the glory I am. And he pared that army down. Pared it down and pared it down until it was only 300. Against an entire army. And at midnight, Gideon and his 300 men crept to the edge of the camp. And they shouted, the sword of the Lord. And for the Lord and for Gideon. And they started banging pots. Started banging. They got perfectly good swords, but they're banging them on pots. I don't know if that's a good idea. Could dull the blade, I don't know, but that's what they did. And they shouted and they made noise, and it to the Philistines sounded like a huge army had encircled their camp. And God did the same thing. He sent his archangel Michael and his armies into that camp in a spirit of confusion and lawlessness and whatever else grabbed hold of them, and they started slaying each other and running for their lives. And Gideon's army crushed them. And countless others in the Bible faced unbelievable odds, and they did what they could do, and God did the rest. They did what they could do, and God did the rest. In your life, whatever you face, do what you can do. Let God do the rest. Don't quit. Don't give up. Love God. Let him. Heavenly Father, we love you and bless you today. We worship you as King of Kings, as Lord of Lords, as very God of very God. You're the God of all the earth. And we love you. We bless you. Father, I pray that in this year you will help each one of us to find our purpose and our destiny and to move forward in you, to make good decisions, to do the things that you instruct us to do. And to let you do the rest. We love you, Father. We love you and we bless you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. God bless you as you go today. If anyone needs prayer, you would like prayer, please feel free to come forward and we'll be happy to pray with you and pray for you at this time. All right, go with God today. God bless you as you go. Go with the Lord.